Welcome. All right. So if everyone can take their seats, please. We're going to get started in just a few minutes. My name is Emma Cantrell, and I'm the Brown Postbaccalaureate Fellow in Museum Education at the Smith College Museum of Art. And on behalf of the museum, I wanted to take this moment to welcome you all to the Guerrilla Girls Public Talk. Tonight's event is in coordination with the museum's current exhibition, Women's Work, Feminist Art from the Collection, which includes several posters by the Guerrilla Girls and is on view until January 3rd. At the end of their talk tonight, we'll have a chance for some Q&A. So there'll be microphones set up on either aisle, and we'll just ask people to line up when that time comes. Can I ask everyone now to take out your cell phones and turn them off, or at least mute them? And I'll ask that there be no flash photography during the event as well. So we are always thrilled to bring artists to campus, but tonight is particularly exciting because the Guerrilla Girls visit was initially proposed by current Smith senior Kate Scrimshaw Hall. A double major in studio art and the study of women and gender, Kate is the current president of the student organization Feminists of Smith Unite, works at SCMA as a student museum educator. Here tonight to introduce the Guerrilla Girls, please welcome Kate Scrimshaw Hall.
Thank you, Emma. I'm so thrilled that the Guerrilla Girls are here tonight on campus and to have played a role in getting them here. To me, as a feminist, as a woman, and as an artist, the work they do is deeply meaningful. It leads us to ask not only why, but why not? Why not more women in art spaces? Why not a more equal representation of women and artists of color in museums and galleries? With humor and art they provoke. There are now hundreds of posters, billboards, and advertisements give voice to the great women artists of the past, but also to women like me. Artists about to be thrown into the thick of the art world with nothing but their own ambition, or women who are already in the thick of it, holding on to each other for support. My hope is that their performance tonight and the exciting arrival of the Women's Work exhibition in the museum will ignite more discussion about the role of women in art and honor contributions of women artists, past, present, and future. Joining us tonight are two members of the group. Please welcome the Guerrilla Girls.
What's very good about our image is that when you look at our masks, you think of what we stand for. And we stand for the conscience of the art world. And we feel that there is underrepresentation of women and minorities. And when you see our logo, basically, when you see our face, that's what we stand for, and it's not personal.
Women artists have never gotten the serious attention and certainly not the serious money that male artists do. Why? The Guerrilla Girls, who call themselves the conscience of the art world, have plastered their answer all over town.
Coming into the city right now, probably 65% of the young artists are females. And yet, less than 10% have their work shown. And that's one of the reasons I'm a Guerrilla Girl.
We believe that getting into a gallery, or being shown in a museum even, is for an artist an employment situation. The question was, how are you going to get women artists recognized when names, lives committed to art was completely ignored by the art history books. And so some of what we did was just attention getting. Anonymous do-gooders like Robin Hood, Batman, Zorro, and the Lone Ranger.
Most of the women who are doing all the bitching are completely talentless. For example, like the top women artists, you don't hear them making these embarrassing feminist pleas. I mean, it's just that these women are, they don't have any talent, and they're taking it out on men.
Everybody who attended the Museum of Modern Art this year went up to the information desk and said, gee, where are the women artists? They put them on the walls.
Anyone want a banana?
Banana for you.
Bananas. Come on.
I can throw a swell if someone can catch.
He's afraid to take a banana. Is there someone who isn't afraid to take a banana? Can you catch it?
All right, two left.
There we go.
What, one
if
here.
If I made this one really special, would someone want it? There we go. You got it? Banana here. Oh, I'd better hurry up. These are magic bananas. When you eat them, strange things happen to your attitudes. There we go. Just one last one. I don't have any insurance, so I have to throw it to someone who can really catch it. There we go, thanks. There is a good principle that created order, light, and man, and an evil principle that created chaos, darkness, and women. Pythagoras, 6th century BC.
Girls begin to talk and stand on their feet sooner than boys because weeds grow more quickly than good crops. Martin Luther, 1533.
I consider female writers, lawyers, and politicians as monsters and nothing but five-legged calves. The woman artist is merely ridiculous, but I am in favor of the female singer and dancer, Auguste Renoir, beloved impressionist painter.
Dear group of communists, you're the strongest bunch of bitches ganged together I've ever seen in the world of art. Don't think to career you will make at 80. Best work of art a woman or girl can make is in bed, making well love, and sometimes procreate non-idiot females. Feminism is the reason of highest number of AIDS statistics in United States of America. Thank to you, bitch feminists, if weakest men become gay. A woman can be genius. Do you remember the Holy Virgin, you damn bunch of whores? Answer me if you have courage, bunch of bitches. Letter to the GGs from an Italian art critic.
My dearest gorillas, I'm in my senior year here at the Willem de Kooning Art Academy in Holland, and I'm so glad you exist, because this year I am the only female in my class who will not be making art of myself naked in order to graduate. It's so frustrating to have my work criticized by my professors for missing that naughty factor. Signed, Gurr.
I'm Zubeda Agha, and this is Frida Kahlo, founding member of the Guerrilla Girls. She's been pretty much involved with everything the group has ever done. And we're so excited to be here at Smith College.
Thank you. Actually, we're happy to be back at Smith College because we were here a few years ago, and your art museum and your archives have always been tremendously supportive of our work from the very, very, very beginning. So we think of you all as family. You know, in 1985, we got the idea to put up just two posters on the streets of New York about the state of female artists in the New York art world. And it wasn't a very pretty picture. But we had this new idea about how to construct political art, how to twist around an issue and present it in some way that took people by surprise, some way that hadn't really been seen before. So the Guerrilla Girls were born. We're an anonymous bunch of female artists who wear our gorilla masks in public and take the names of dead artists as pseudonyms. Over 55 individuals have been members of the Guerrilla Girls, some for weeks, some for decades, some for just a few meetings. We've always been diverse in age, sexual orientation, class, and we've been from many ethnic backgrounds, South Asian, Asian, African American, Latino, European, etc. We've had cisgendered and transgendered members from the very beginning.
Who knew that our work would cause all hell to break loose? Who knew it would cause a major crisis of conscience about diversity in the art world, a subject museums, collectors, and critics had ignored and denied for a long, long time? Now it's a no-brainer. You can't tell a story of a culture without all the voices in it.
But there's a ton of bias and corruption in the art world, and because artists get caught up in it, in the economy of it all, it's really hard for them to admit it openly. And that's another reason why, after 30 years, these masks are still necessary.
Who knew our first two posters would lead to hundreds of others, plus street actions, billboards, stickers, and books? Not just about art, but about the worlds of film, politics, and pop culture. Who knew that 30 years later, we, the agitating outsiders, would wind up inside the museums we criticize, at the Museum of Modern Art, Tate Modern London, where a room of our posters is on permanent display, and the Reina Sofia in Madrid?
Who knew that we'd do large-scale street projects in cities like Rotterdam, Mexico City, Istanbul, Athens, and Shanghai? A major retrospective of our work was in Bilbao 2 years ago and moved on to Madrid, Spain, and part of it is being prepared for an exhibition in London next year.
We've been so lucky to do this work, and we're so grateful of the thousands of people all over the world aged 8 to 80 who write telling us that we've inspired them to do their own crazy, creative kind of activism.
Now, we started out sneaking around in the middle of the night, putting up posters all over New York, posters that revealed the truth about discrimination in the New York art world. And by the way, here's one of our street shots. And in case you don't realize it, putting a poster on a US mailbox is a federal offense. But we did it because we were pissed off. And the posters all of a sudden caught everyone's attention and everyone started talking about the issues. Now, this is an example of how bad things were. I mean, we weren't talking about how, you know, things were 50% this or 13% that. We were complaining about 0, 0, 1, 0. And soon the word on the street was that the Guerrilla Girls were a bunch of whining complainers. So negative. So we took this criticism to heart and decided to do a poster to help artists be more positive about their situation. And here is the advantages of being a woman artist. Zubeda?
Working without the pressures of success.
Not having to be, or not being stuck in a tenured teaching position.
Being included in every revised version of art history.
Not having to undergo the embarrassment of being considered a genius.
Getting your picture taken in the art magazines wearing a gorilla suit.
Now, this poster has been translated into many, many languages, and hardly a week goes by when we don't get a letter from someone in fields as diverse as, you know, mortuary science, unbelievable. Mortuary science, veterinary science, music, physics, etc., telling us that this poster is not just about the art world, it's about their lives too.
A few years later, we were invited to do a billboard in Manhattan and try out this crazy voice we'd developed on a larger audience. So we went to the Metropolitan Museum to conduct what we have affectionately come to call the Weenie Count.
So some of you get what the Weenie Count was. We counted naked males and naked females in the collection just to see what it might tell us. So when we went through the classical art galleries, most of the naked figures were male. When we went through the early Christian sections, we couldn't find any flesh at all. When we went through the Renaissance and Baroque galleries, the only fully frontal naked figure we could find belonged to the baby Jesus. It was only when we got to the 19th and 20th centuries, that early modern era when sex replaced religion as the major preoccupation of European artists, did we get this statistic. So what we did is we appropriated Ang's odalisque. We had her ask the question, do women have to be naked to get into the Metropolitan Museum? And the answer was, less than 5% of the artists in the modern art section are women, but 85% of the nudes are female.
Now, we'd like to think our work has made a big difference in the art world, but old habits die hard, and some museums are still lagging behind. We went back to the Met a couple of years ago to see if anything had gotten better. We were sure it had, but this is what we found.
Fewer women artists, but more naked males. This is progress.
In the mid-1990s, the buzzword in the US art world was multiculturalism. Art institutions were playing catch-up, showing one or two artists of each marginalized group. But instead of showing the great diversity of artists from these groups, most museums were showing the same artists over and over again.
So we decided to do a campaign about tokenism because we wanted to ask the question, is tokenism a solution or merely a continuation of the problem of exclusion? And here is top 10 signs that you're an art world token. Now, every one of these situations happened to members of our group.
Your busiest months are February, Black History Month, March, Women's History Month, April, Asian American Awareness, June, Stonewall Anniversary, and September, Latino Heritage.
At parties and openings, the only other people of color are serving the drinks.
Whenever you open your mouth, it's assumed you speak for your people and not just yourself.
At parties, everyone ends up telling you their interracial, gay, and transgender sexual fantasies.
A museum that won't exhibit your work gives you a prominent place in its lecture series.
Now, recently, we've been busier than ever, but we've been faced with this huge dilemma. What do you do when the system that you've spent your entire life attacking suddenly embraces you? In 2005, we were asked to do a large-scale installation at the Venice Biennale. In the last couple of years, our work has been seen at major museums all over the world, mostly European museums, not American museums. There's a good reason for that.
But so what's an activist to do? We've agonized over it, but for now we've made the decision to participate in exhibitions and appearances at museums because we really want our work to get out. We want our message to get out to an audience as large as possible. And it's really a thrill to criticize art institutions on their walls.
So here's what we did in Venice. We did an installation of six 17-foot high posters that were the first things that viewers saw when they entered the main exhibition hall of the Arsenale.
We took on the Biennale itself, documenting 110 years of discrimination. But we also declared it the first feminist biennale. Why? Because it had the first women directors ever, and surprise, the highest number of women artists ever.
So we also took on the historic museums in Venice because we discovered that every one of them except one did have work by female artists in the collection, but almost all of the work was kept not on the walls, but in the basements. So here we have, we appropriated this iconic image of Marcello Mastroianni straddling Anita Ekberg from the famous Fellini film La Dolce Vita.
We're asking the question, where are the women artists of Venice? The answer, underneath the men. Then we demanded that viewers go to the museums of Venice and tell them to put more women on top.
Okay, now when the Washington Post newspaper gave us a full page as part of a special section on feminism and art, we decided that we would design our own tabloid, the Not Okay Guerrilla Girls Scandal Rag, to reveal the shocking, shocking truth about the low, low number of women and artists of color in our U.S. national malls in Washington. And here it is, horror on the National Mall. Thousands of women locked in the museums of D.C., the basements of D.C. museums.
Now, we got all of our statistics for this project from the museum themselves or from their website, but when the Post called to fact check, the museums went bananas. The National Gallery hurriedly installed a sculpture by an artist of color, and the Hirshhorn Museum suddenly found works it had never knew it owned.
And by the way, this is how bad it was in 2008 at our taxpayer-supported museums in Washington. The National Gallery of Art, in case you can't read it, 98% male, 99.9% white, and that's because overnight they installed a sculpture by an African-American. Now, the Hirshhorn Museum, which is the Museum of Modern and Contemporary Art, was 95% male, and 94% white.
We've always wondered if the problem didn't start because lots of museums have the names of dead white males inscribed on their facades. Our solution, replacing names like Leonardo and Michelangelo with artists like Artemisia, Frida Kahlo, Rosa Bonheur, Alma Thomas, and Claude Cahun.
Okay, speaking of Claude Cahun, I don't know how many of you know about Claude Cahun, but we wrote about her in our Bedside Companion to the History of Western Art. Claude Cahun lived in France in the mid-20th century and made self-portraits in all manner of gender roles. Claude was actually born Lucy Schwab, and her life partner and step-sibling, Suzanne Malherbe, also renamed himself becoming Marcel. And some books on surrealism list Claude as a male, others as a female. And the Guerrilla Girls think, really, that art history needs many new categories, vocabulary, many new ways to describe the uniqueness of artists like Claude Cahun.
We love art and artists, but let's face it, while there are lots of people who care about art, there are also lots of posers, snobs, gamblers, tax dodgers, inside traders, and even criminals. The art business market is unregulated. In fact, it's described as the fourth largest black market in the world, after drugs, guns, and diamonds. Here's our version of the history of art museums from the Guerrilla Girls Art Museum Activity Book.
A brief history of museums. It all began because rich people have always had a lot of stuff. And when they ran out of space in their palaces and churches, they needed somewhere to store it all. Bingo! They invented art museums. In Europe, art museums are part of the government and they're run by civil servants and bureaucrats. But in the United States, museums are funded and overseen by super rich art collectors, the 1% of the 1%.
Now, it doesn't take a genius to realize that this system is ripe for corruption. These billionaire collectors sit on the boards of directors of museums and influence what museums exhibit and collect. They get museums to purchase work by artists they already own, increasing the value of their personal collection. American capitalism at its finest.
Okay, so I assume you're all like art, like we do. So let's take a short art quiz. Of the top 100 art auction sales, how many were of work by women? None.
What does art by famous females cost compared to famous males? 12%.
The highest sale ever for a living female artist, $7 million for Yayo Kusama, is only 12% of the highest sale for a male, $58.4 million for a Jeff Koons.
Next question. Can you make money from a museum while you're on its board of trustees?
$11 million says yes, because that's what Count Giuseppe Panza was paid for selling part of his art collection to the Museum of Contemporary Art in Los Angeles while he was on its board. He also sold other pieces from his collection to the Guggenheim that year for $30 million.
What's one of the economic forces behind the new Guggenheim Museum in Abu Dhabi?
Debt bondage. Foreign workers on the Guggenheim and in the surrounding luxury zone are hired in South Asia and flown to the Emirates. When they arrive, their passports are confiscated, and the pay is nothing like what they were promised. They're forced to live under inhumane conditions like this and work for a pittance. What's more important to the Metropolitan Museum than free speech?
Money. The Met recently accepted a $65 million donation from the ultra-right-wing Koch brothers, who spend even more than that trying to undermine US elections. What did the Met do after getting their dirty money? They held a big party and then called in the cops to arrest a group of artists who protested outside by projecting this image onto the facade of the museum.
Okay, what about some outrageous, or shall we say, artrageous fun facts about one museum trustee who went to jail?
Alfred Taubman, who made big bucks building shopping centers, sat on the board of the Whitney Museum of American Art while he was also owner of Sotheby's Auction House. At the Whitney, he knew in advance which artists the museum would be showing and acquiring, information that was very useful to his auction house. No one questioned this at the time, but in 2002, he went to prison for price fixing with rival auction house Christie's.
And you know, Alfred passed away a couple of years ago, and his collection is now on exhibit at Sotheby's, and it's going to be auctioned off next week. So please watch our Facebook page. Something is going to happen. Now, speaking of billionaires in the art market and on museum boards, here's a stealth sticker campaign we did last spring in New York. We put up stickers about income inequality, calling out the culture of the super rich who control art. And with the help of the Illuminator Collective, those guys who did all those wonderful Occupy projections years ago, we projected an animation right onto the brand new Whitney Museum the first day it was open. And here's something about it.
So the world of artists is great, but the art world sucks. The super rich are controlling the museums, sitting on the boards.
Power is being centralized into these few rich people. Like, it's really about the 1%.
Unfortunately, the art world right now appears to be about money and about the production of luxury items.
Billionaires are making more and more and more, and their taste controls which artists get the big bucks and get the opportunities and get the shows. We're planning to sneak around New York with the Illuminator. So we'll be starting out in Chelsea, and we hope to then go to the Whitney.
The van's coming from another secret place. We have no idea where it's kept, and we don't really understand all the stuff inside it, but we know that it does magic. We're gonna meet up with it at a predetermined place. Coordinating it is kind of complicated, lots of text messages, lots of back and forth. But we don't know what the traffic is going to be like. And then when it comes by, we're going to have to like jump in the van and take off. We have to suss out the museum, make sure that there's no cops there, no beefy guards.
So we had this idea to do something we could do really fast around New York and put these stickers up. Some of the stickers are about art galleries, about billionaires, billionaire collectors, and about museums. So we wanted to put them up where they belong, on the big galleries, on the museums, and give them out to people, especially so they could do the same thing. And it seemed like a great idea. Call people together, just put the word out, see who comes, and just run around the streets and put these things up and bother people.
It's going to be a Saturday in Chelsea. People walking around, feeling really good about having seen all this inspiring art. And all of a sudden, they're going to see the wall above start talking to them. And it's going to say, "Dear art collector, we completely get it. Collecting art is so expensive. We really understand why you can't afford to pay all your employees a living wage." The wall is going to talk to them. Every time we put something up, you know, people would go bananas. Some people would love it, some people would hate it. So we would sort of work in that space. It's really very productive to provoke people to think about things. And we discovered early on that if you could make someone who disagreed with you laugh, you know, you had a hook inside their brain. You know, once you were in there, you just might be able to change their minds about things.
Okay, let's cut to an area of U.S. culture that's even worse than the art world. Thank you. Worse than the art world? Hollywood. Now, the film industry wants you to think of itself as edgy and progressive and ahead of the curve. But if you look behind the scenes at writers, directors, editors, you will find that almost all of them are white males.
So for several years, we rented billboards in Hollywood just a few blocks from where the Academy Awards were held. And for our first one in 2002, we decided it was time to put a little realism into the Academy Awards. So we decided that we would redesign the Golden Boy to look a little bit more like the guys who took him home.
Presenting the anatomically correct Oscar. He's white and male, just like the guys who win. We had to back up this outrageous statement with facts. Now, at the time, no woman had ever won Best Director, 94% of the writing awards had gone to men, and only 3% of the acting awards had gone to actors of color.
Now, that was the very year that both Denzel Washington and Halle Berry both won Oscars for their performances. And we're convinced it was because of this billboard.
A few years later, Monique, Octavia Spencer, and Lupita became the 5th, 6th, and 7th black women in 86 years to win an Oscar for acting. Jeffrey Fletcher and John Ridley became the first black men to win for screenwriting, and Kathryn Bigelow became the first woman to win Best Director, and only 4th ever to be nominated. And of course, we take credit for all of that, too.
And you know, the funny thing is, Hollywood producers since then have always been coming around us, asking that, you know, us to help them do a movie about the history of feminism.
But right after we tell them our ideas, we never hear from them again. And one day we got to thinking, what if Hollywood did make a film about the history of 1960s and 70s feminism? What would it be like? And the minute that thought flew into our heads, another thought flew right behind it. Maybe we're lucky that Hollywood hasn't made that film. So we decided to create the movie poster for the film we hope never gets made the Hollywood way.
A major Hollywood studio presents The Birth of Feminism. So we cast our movie with three luscious babes. No Hollywood movie would be complete without at least one. So we have Pamela Anderson as feminist leader Gloria Steinem, Halle Berry as the great civil rights lawyer Florence Kennedy, and Catherine Zeta-Jones as Congresswoman Bella Abzug. And our tagline, they made women's rights look good, really good.
Now, those of you who have studied the 70s feminist movement or were part of it will appreciate that our poster is historically accurate, since the great leaders of the feminist movement did wear bikinis 90% of the time. And to round out our credits, our movie was directed by Oliver Stone and had a soundtrack by Eminem. Of course.
Okay, that brings us to the music business, because two springs ago, Pharrell Williams invited us to be in a show in Paris about femininity, and we decided that to participate in it, we would demand to do a couple new projects for it, including this repurposed version of our best-known poster.
This time we're asking, do women have to be naked to get into music videos when 99% of the men are fully dressed? Anyone recognize the video the naked female body comes from? Blurred Lines.
Okay, now for some politics, pure politics, because we've done lots of posters about politics and social issues. You know, people have always been asking us, what are the Guerrilla Girls doing to help our country fight the war against terrorism?
We've decided that the world needs a new weapon to fight the dangers that face our world. Here it is at Yoko Ono's Meltdown Festival.
Okay, here's how the estrogen bomb works. You drop it on the superpowers, and the presidents, prime ministers, generals, oligarchs, and CEOs everywhere will throw down their big guns. They'll hug each other. They'll apologize. They'll say, I'm really sorry. No, it was my fault. Back and forth until one of them says, why don't we get busy and just clean up this mess? Let's work on human rights for all, education, healthcare, and an end to income inequality.
An estrogen bomb was recently dropped on Vladimir Putin. Its name is Pussy Riot.
In 2009, we did a poster about hatred and violence against women that appeared on the streets of Montreal on the 20th anniversary of the worst Canadian mass murder ever, when a gunman by the name of Mark Lapine claimed he was fighting feminism. He entered the engineering school in Montreal, the École Polytechnique. He separated the women students from the male students, and he proceeded to shoot and murder 14 women studying engineering in Montreal.
This is the project we created. Our poster is a graffiti wall of sexist hate speech through the centuries, from Plato to Confucius, who once said, 100 women are not worth a single testicle, to Pat Robertson, who said, feminism is a socialist anti-family movement that encourages women to leave their husbands, kill their children, destroy capitalism, and worst of all, become lesbians.
You know, it struck us that it's still okay to publicly say things about women and also trans people that would not be tolerated if said about other groups. Case in point, remember when U.S. shock radio host Rush Limbaugh said that college students who use birth control are prostitutes and sluts? And then there's Donald Trump. Well, he gets away with insulting everybody.
Now, we've taken on all kinds of issues that we're passionate about. And a couple of years ago, we finished a new book about a topic that is very important to us, the female body and how it's been treated. Only a few people have seen this, and we're excited to present it to you. The Hysterical History of Hysteria and How It Was Cured, from ancient times until now.
And it also gives us the opportunity to sing to you a little bit.
No.
Sorry about that. I didn't sing very well, but I'm going to give it a try. Still crazy after all these years. Once upon a time, women in Europe and America suffered from a terrible disease called hysteria.
The symptoms were nervousness, fatigue, anxiety, insomnia, faintness, muscle spasms, shortness of breath, irritability, headaches, heaviness of the abdomen, fluid retention, lack of concentration, depression, loss of appetite for food or sex, ticklishness, and making trouble. Doctors claim 2 out of every 3 women suffered from this awful affliction.
No one knew what caused hysteria, but the great minds of science decided that it had to have something to do with those mysterious female sexual organs.
Something in the way she moves. In ancient Greece, Plato believed the uterus wandered around the female body, choking and strangling all normal functions as it went.
Pleased to meet you. Guess you know my name. In the Middle Ages, people thought that females who showed extreme symptoms of hysteria had to be possessed by the devil. They were witches. And we all know what the cures for being a witch was. Burning at the stakes and hanging.
Hit me with your best shot. In the Renaissance, special instruments were developed to purge women of hysteria. Lots of Dutch houses had a wooden syringe in the outhouse. It was hollow and shot medicinal fluids into one's vagina to flush out the unsavory stuff inside that caused hysteria.
And in Italy, a device like at the bottom was used to fumigate a female vagina with hot vapors. Ouch.
Dr. Feelgood. Another treatment for hysteria, if you could afford it, involved a physician massaging the inside edges of a patient's vagina with aromatic oils.
And if the procedure were successful, the patient would fall into a frenzied state of moaning and groaning, sometimes over and over again.
It was not unusual for the patient to lose consciousness or fall asleep. When revived, she was in a state of calm relaxation, cured until her next episode of hysteria.
Now, some were fortunate enough to have this procedure as often as once a week. And it was especially effective on virgins, widows, and nuns. We're not making this up. This is true. Sometimes the treatment would just take a couple of minutes. Other times it took hours. What a lot of work for those doctors.
Well, reality check here. This is science. Doctors gave patients orgasms and got paid for it. Was it health care or prostitution?
Good, good, good vibrations. After the electric motor was invented in the 19th century, doctors came up with all kinds of exciting new ways to treat the ever-present problem of female hysteria. They used newfangled vibrating machines like here, like these in the pictures, directly on their patients' genitals.
And once electricity became available in private homes, the cure for hysteria could be administered right in the privacy of one's bedroom. Portable vibrators appeared 10 years before vacuums and irons. Sears Roebuck, a prominent American mail order store, had a version with special attachments. Once the patient felt better, she could clean the house with the same machine.
Girls just want to have fun. Well, the porn industry discovered the vibrator in the 1920s, and psychiatrists were horrified to see right there on the screen a medical device used for sexual pleasure. Vibrators were declared lascivious and immoral, and stores like Sears stopped selling them, although you might find some at antique stores. As late as 2008, it was a crime to sell vibrators in Texas. It's still illegal to sell a vibrator in Alabama.
R-E-S-P-E-C-T. Vibrators became the best friend of many and are still at the center of a thriving sex toy industry. Around 1952, the medical profession finally dropped hysteria as a serious female disease. That just so happened to be the very same year that Simone de Beauvoir published her manifesto, The Second Sex, which jump-started the women's liberation movement. Coincidence?
You know, feminism helped everybody understand how society has constrained, misunderstood, and treated bodies over the century. So maybe we could think of feminism as the medicine that cured hysteria.
A few years ago, the Guerrilla Girls gave our first ever commencement address at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. That's fun. In front of 4,000 cheering people in Millennium Park, here are some excerpts, rants, from our manifesto.
It's the Guerrilla Girls' Guide to Behaving Badly, which you have to do most of the time in the world as we know it. Now, this is a guide for artists, art and culture workers, and just anyone who's trying to change an entrenched system.
Be a loser. The world of art doesn't have to be an Olympics where a few win and everyone else is forgotten. The art market and its hyper-competitive celebrity culture makes everyone but the stars feel like failures.
But there's another world out there that's not about raging egos. It's a world of artistic cooperation and collaboration. That's the world that we joined, and we invite all of you to join us too. Let's make trouble together.
Number two, be crazy. Political art or activism that simply points to something and says, this is bad, is preaching to the choir. Instead, try to change people's minds and do it in some unforgettable way. Here's what we've learned. Humor helps you fly under the radar. If you can get people who disagree with you to laugh at an issue, you have a hook into their brain. And once there, you have a much better chance to convert them.
Be anonymous. Sometimes you gotta speak out publicly, but sometimes it works even better to speak out anonymously. Now, this has some disadvantages, like working your whole life without getting any credit. But it has lots of advantages too. Our anonymity, for example, keeps the focus on the issues and away from our individual personalities. And the mystery of who we might be draws lots of attention to the issues we raise. Plus, I gotta be honest, you won't believe what comes out of your mouth when you're wearing a gorilla mask.
Be an outsider. Even if you're working inside the system, we say act like an outsider. Seek out the understory, the subtext, the overlook, and the downright unfair. Then expose it. Jam your culture. Remake your institution.
Just do one thing. If it works, do another. If it doesn't work, do another anyway. Don't be paralyzed if you don't get it right every time. Just keep chipping away. We promise that bit by bit, your efforts will add up to something effective.
As you've seen, we've done hundreds of banners, billboards all over the world. But there are lots of simple things that we've done that you can do too.
Well, for example, you could stick flyers in the books in museum stores. Doesn't hurt a thing. Or even bookstores. You can paste messages up on the inside of toilet stalls. You can attach hang tags with political messages on merchandise in big box stores. Doesn't hurt anything. Put up street art across from your workplace. Slap stickers on offensive fashion magazines.
In 5 minutes, this crowd could think up 100 other ideas.
And those of you who are going to participate in our workshop tomorrow, it's going to be so much fun. Artists, don't make expensive art that only billionaire art collectors can afford. Curators, don't exhibit only the expensive art that your trustees own and donate.
We need more cheap art that everyone can own, like books, zines, music, and movies, like our posters.
Show museums tough love. It's unethical that wealthy art collectors who invest lots of money in art can become museum trustees overseeing institutions that can in turn revalidate their investments. That's a really lousy way to write and preserve our history.
We have to all demand ethical standards inside museums. No more conflicts of interests or insider trading. No more cookie-cutter collections of art that cost the most.
And convince art collectors that their collections are actually inferior if they only have work by white male artists.
We really can't let museums perpetuate this version of art and power with a few tokens thrown in. We have to make sure that your favorite museum casts a wider net and collects the whole story of our culture.
And finally, whether you work in a museum or in a classroom, don't feel you have to teach an art history constructed by a corrupt institution. Do like we did. Write your own history.
And always complain, complain, complain. But be a creative complainer. Be a professional creative complainer.
Don't assume that people always know what's missing from museums. Remind them how many modern and contemporary museums still contain 85% white male art. When we put up banners and posts and billboards about the pathetically low number of females and people of color in art collections or working in the film industry, people tell us how shocked they are that they didn't know that fact before.
My favorite, use the F word, feminism. It's so crazy that so many people who believe in the tenets of feminisms are still afraid to call themselves feminists. Feminism doesn't get the respect it deserves. Women's rights, civil rights, lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender rights are the great human rights movements of our times.
Feminism is changing the world. It's revolutionized human thought. It's given so many people lives that their great grandparents could never have imagined.
But there's still so much work to do. There are so many countries worldwide where LGBT people and women have little or no human rights.
And did you know that 90% of transgender employees have faced discrimination or harassment at work? And in the United States, no federal law protects them, even though nearly 80% of the voters in the American public would support such a law.
Violence and abuse against women and transgender people is still a huge international problem, from gang rape in India, to kidnapping in Nigeria, to sexual slavery by ISIS and the Taliban, to the negligible punishment given out for domestic violence here in America.
And we don't have to remind you the rampant sexism in the tech industry, including the harassment of female gamers.
And what about the gender earning gap that US Congress still refuses to move against, and the harassment that women and trans people have to face every day at school, at work, and in the streets?
But despite all the bad news, feminist resistance movements are exploding everywhere. That F-word feminism, we think also is the F-word that stands for the future. So let's all of us join together as feminists on the right side of history. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. Okay, it's your turn now to ask us a question, make a complaint, give a rant, you know, whatever you want. I think you have to line up on either side of the room at the microphones. So give me a chance to get a little drink here. So yes, who would like to go first? Would you like to go?
Sure. I just had a question about like mitigating your claim to like cheap art, and then when you sell art to places like the Smith College Museum or whatever, like do you sell your art for like the same price, or you know, how do you work out price negotiations when you do work within the system in museums, and how does that work against like the 12% figure you were talking about?
Yeah.
I don't know if that makes sense.
Well, we really don't care about being at the top of that list. We wish that, you know, that the art market were more inclusive and didn't put all its, you know, all its money on a few artists. That's sort of like the Olympics, and it really is doesn't tell a rich story of history. You can go to our website and buy any of our posters for $20. That's really cheap. That's cheap art. We just launched a little sort of a series of products that's at the Museum of Modern Art right now, which are coffee cups, tea towels, and handkerchiefs, and they all cost $20 a piece. I mean, for sure they're being sold in the museum, but we demanded that the price be low, and we made the statement that we don't have any fancy rich art collectors. We just want people to take our work into their real lives. Now, when we do sell a portfolio, the only way to get the entire gamut of all the work that we've done is to purchase a portfolio. Those are a little more expensive because we have to survive. And they're not as expensive as many, many other things in the world. They're very cheap, actually. But we like them to coexist in art collections next to all the very super expensive $1 million sculptures as a record of history. So someone 200 years from now will look at the Jeff Koons and then look at our portfolio and say, hey, what was happening? And our portfolios tell the whole story of how our thinking has evolved and how the issues have evolved and changed. You know, what the situation that existed in 1985 isn't the situation that exists here right now. And if you look closely at our posters chronologically, you'll see that.
Hi, I'm wondering what you think of that guy who stands in front of museums with posters that say, Renoir sucks at painting.
Well, you know, we try not to, you know, criticize other people's protests, you know, power to them. He hates Renoir, all right? You know, we have some issues with Renoir too, to be honest.
Yes.
Hi, I was wondering, you talk a lot about the way that women are portrayed in art and the way that people of color are portrayed in art, but
I haven't heard you talk about the intersection of the two as women of color who are artists, and you know, talking about the issues that women face and the issues that trans people face, but also trans women. And I was wondering how you guys have those conversations about art within the group, especially when you are wearing masks. And so at least, I mean, we as the viewer can make assumptions about what we think your backgrounds are, but how do you keep yourselves accountable when in some ways that part of your identity is hidden?
Well, you know, our group changes all the time. And we don't wear these masks at meetings. We actually have meetings face to face. And we're constantly arguing about that. And I think the situation is evolving. Our critique is evolving. You know, I would change a lot of the language in some of our early posters now because that vocabulary isn't used anymore. And we only knew what was known then. So I would say we're constantly disagreeing about things and arguing about them. We try to be as open to ideas and as evolving as possible. And it isn't just about working for women and artists of color, it's really working for everyone who's not part of the establishment. And I hate to say it, that's usually white men. Not all white men, but usually white men. So we would like to think of feminism as being a way of combating the patriarchy, and the patriarchy is the establishment. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
I want to piggyback a little bit. I think as a group, we've always had women of color, you know, people who didn't, you know, associate with like female gender totally. So I think as a group, those conversations have always been very honest, and we've always, as a group, been able to talk about it. So it's not, I don't know how to...
Well, we argue about it, too. And
yeah, we fight about it a lot.
Thank you.
If someone wants to become a Guerrilla Girl, is there an application process or something you have to do?
It's the 7 tests of feminism. You have to burn your bra, trace down your family lineage.
Do you want to answer that?
Sure. You know, we get asked that a lot, and honestly, I wish we could let everybody in, but we are sort of a collective, and we have to get together and work and do sort of like boring stuff, like have meetings and emails and things like that. So it's... we wish we could take everyone in, but we can't. But we want everyone else to go and form their own secret feminist group, you know? Put on your own mask and do something else.
So there's no opportunity for that to happen?
You know, you shouldn't take no for an answer. Go, you don't need us. I'm bossy. but wouldn't it be scary if there were more feminist mass avenger groups in the world?
On that note, I'm a trans performance worker who studies over at Hampshire, and I was wondering where you see the value of performativity in your work and how it could relate to stuff done by like ACT UP and other sort of confrontational groups that you guys have like cornered the market.
Well, you know, we did it our own way, which is we were really cowards, and we snuck around in the middle of the night and put up posters. And then the next day, usually we did it on a Friday night in Soho, and on Saturday was a big gallery day, so we would take our masks. Well, no, actually, we never wore our masks when we put the posters up, because that would have gotten too much attention. And then we would hang out the next day by the posters as ourselves, listening to what people would say. And then we would incorporate their ideas into our next set of posters. So we were never really performance artists. It just, over time, there was a performative nature to this weird, you know, persona that we developed and worked on. So I think whatever works, do it. You know, and I'm so happy to see we go to so many art schools where students are not prepping themselves to be gallery artists, they're prepping themselves to be art activists. And they really want to use their creative skills to change the world. And I remember being in school a long time ago and a teacher saying to me, "You'll never change the world with your art."
Ha ha.
So it's really inspiring to hear you guys talk about your history and see all of your art and how it really takes statistics to show just sort of like the reality of the situation. And being a Smith student, it's hard to not notice that even in our own institution, at our art museum, there is such inequality of what is shown. And right now the women's work exhibit is so amazing, but it's really small and it's temporary. So there's definitely these problems here and we need to be talking about it. Do you have any advice for students here to make our institution accountable and to make like our spaces, like our museum, more representative of what we want to see in the like art world at large?
You know what I think is, what's really great about the point you made is a lot of people think that, you know, this gender inequality in the art world and in institutions was an issue that was in the 60s and the 70s and then it was solved. And they don't realize that it's actually worse now. For this is our 30th anniversary, and this year to sort of celebrate, we did a recount of some of our earliest posters that we did in 1985. So one of the most iconic ones we did was how many women had one person shows at museums, and it was 0010. And then we did a recount this year and it was 1121. And people really didn't think that it was still an issue, and it is. And you know, I think people don't believe it if you just say it. As soon as we present them with numbers, then all of a sudden everybody's shocked. So that's sort of, I think that would be my number one advice. Present them with the numbers, because the numbers don't lie. But you also, like just like you're doing right now, you have to hold them accountable. You have to ask the questions. Don't just believe that what's presented at the museum, oh, this is art and this is what was good art. You have to ask, what is not here? What are we not seeing?
You know, history is such a rich, you know, just such a rich tapestry. And how can you tell the story of a diverse culture without all the voices of the diversity in it? Otherwise, it's just a history of power. And I come to our workshop tomorrow and we'll figure out some ways you can deal with it.
I'm one of the curators at the art museum here.
Oh no! You!
And we're thrilled that you're here. I just want to rise in defense of the art that we show. We recently closed an exhibition of the work of Mary Bauermeister. I know you know who she is.
Sure.
And she's a largely forgotten female artist in this country. She came and worked in this country in the 60s, and a lot of museums bought her work and put it in their basement. And we did a show. A lot of that work came out of the basement, and now she's going to get a retrospective in New York in the spring. So
great.
Activism does work. And we collect and show a lot of women artists, including living artists and not living artists. Katie Kollwitz is going to have a major show. She has passed, but she's a great woman artist from the 20th century, and she'll be shown next spring. So we show lots of women artists. And one of the things I want to highlight is the fact that Smith College students have had and continue to have effects on the museum and on what we show. The Black Student Alliance bought an Emma Amos painting for us, which is on view in the feminism show.
Oh, great.
The Korean American students of Smith College got together and bought a major installation by Young Soon Min for the museum as well. So I throw the challenge right back to the students here because you have precedents before you of students who were activists and made a big had a big effect on the museum and on our permanent collection and on what we show. And I have to say, too, that the feminist show came out of some focus groups that we did with students and with faculty. We asked point blank, what do you want to see in our collection more? And they said feminist art, and we went out and we got it.
Yay.
So,
great.
So we respond to students, and we would love to hear more from you. And if you want to buy us any more art or give us any more art, buy women artists. We are there waiting for you. And thank you so much for coming.
And thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you. Okay, let's ask this question.
Hi, I came all the way from Vernon, Connecticut tonight. To see you and hear about the Guerrilla Girls. I'm a docent at the New Britain Museum of American Art in New Britain, Connecticut. And I just wanted to say, I think things are changing because our director, Douglas Hyland, is retiring. He's been a great director. His mother was a sculptor. And I think we've made great strides in collecting, showing more women artists at our museum. And now we have a woman director, and I expect things to change even more. She's a Korean American. Her name is Min Jong Kim. And I was wondering, have any Guerrilla Girls been to the New Britain Museum?
I don't think so, but we'd love to go sometime.
Well, I invite you to come in. We just opened a new expansion, the building dedicated to art and education, and it's beautiful. The whole museum has just changed.
This is our dog and pony show. We do this, we love to do this in front of crowds. It's, you know, how we survive, it's how we get on, it's also how we communicate with a lot of people and how we hear, you know, from other people. But in turn, I wouldn't be too Pollyannish about the art world because, and I challenge you all, those of you who like read the New York Times and read the auction results, there are auctions coming up in November, and see how many women artists, artists of color, and trans artists ever come up at auction. Because right now, the art market is driving, you know, the collecting habits of the big museums. And we all know that the money goes right to, you know, does not go, you know, to women, artists of color, or trans artists. So I challenge you to keep your eyes open and notice those results and see what you think of the pathetic amount of money that's invested in the work of women artists.
I agree, and I'm always pushing for, you know, more women's tours, et cetera, and showing more of the work in our collection by women.
But it's a systematic problem, or a systemic problem. And, I mean, everything that's wrong with the American economy and political system has always been wrong in the art world.
Well, still,
it's nothing new.
I think that there's hope when we have a new woman director, and that in itself is progress.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Hi. Wow. So I think there's been some sort of tangential discussion about how, like, institutions can act as points of access and as barriers simultaneously tonight. And so I'm wondering, like, specifically as a college student, there are so many associations with activism and higher ed that make activist communities very inaccessible. And so so much of your work is based in education and public education. And so I was wondering how that factors in to your work in making it accessible to the quote-unquote masses. Thank you.
Well, you know, we've sort of created a different paradigm in the art world. You know, it's a surprise to us that we're mentioned in all these art history books. It's like, whoa, how did that happen? We've never participated in the art market. It's colleges and universities and art curricula, gender studies curricula have kept us alive. And I think our entire 30 years, we were very quickly picked up by educational institutions, and they supported us for years doing residencies and talks and workshops and things like that. And most of our portfolios are owned by museums in teaching institutions. We're really proud of that. They're all being used in classrooms. And I think it's because we don't tell happy news. And our work is an analysis of the art world. As I said, if you look at, you can go online to our website and look at the earliest posters and the latest posters, and then see it. They tell a story next to each other, and it's an educational story, you know, of our culture. So I think it was never intentional. It's just because we told an unhappy story that the art market never was interested in, and it's only recently that museums have come calling. For years, we would go to every college in the Midwest. I remember going 10 of them in a week, you know, talking to students, talking to audiences, you know, talking to faculty. So we've always been educational, and we always insist that there be some information in every one of our, you know, artworks. Sure.
Do you have any advice on how to gather people in activist movements that are, like you said, coming from a point of being an outsider and being anonymous? And how do you gather people in that kind of activist movement,
especially from like a student perspective?
Well, you should come to our workshop tomorrow.
You have secret meetings, and you realize that you can't collaborate with everyone. It's a certain, you have to have the right chemistry. Mm-hmm. You have to learn to be patient with one another. And it takes a lot of work.
It's a lot of hard work. I think going in, there was this grand idealistic idea that we would all get together and complain, but it's, you have to work as a group.
And never give up.
Hi.
Hi.
I just wanted to know again what your definition of feminism was first. Is the first part of my question.
I think it evolves. Mm-hmm. And I think every one of us has a different definition. I kind of don't believe in a monolithic idea of feminism because I realize that each culture presents a different circumstance. But for me, it's the fact that everyone has equal rights. Everyone. And we need to fight for the fact, you know, for that cause.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm speaking as like a woman who wouldn't have access to this talk if it weren't for my, like, higher, if it wasn't for Hampshire College, like if I didn't go to that school. So I'm interested to see sort of what your definition of feminism is in regard to intersectionality, if it is this thing that like is equal rights for everyone. As a woman who wouldn't be here if it weren't for sort of getting rolled this lucky card and getting into this institution.
Yeah.
I have nothing to add. Like, I feel exactly the same way. It's really about everyone. And not everyone agrees with sort of what I'm fighting for, but for me, it's not about just, you know, a certain type of woman getting to the top. It's not even about just women getting to the top. It's
for
about
sure,
it's about the story being richer than that.
Absolutely. It's even a little hard to stand here and look at the monkeys. It's so hard, just historically, black women, you know, being called monkeys,
yeah.
And, you know, and having like our existence equated to animals,
yeah.
And just like that, it's just so hard to have this conversation now. That's just why I wanted to know your definition.
Yeah, well, you know, we had that argument too, and we had that argument, and we decided we wanted to be as unexpected and as surprising and to claim things. So that's why we called ourselves guerrillas, why we called ourselves girls, why we took this
Thank
mask.
You.
It's time. You know, what's wrong with guerrillas?
I'm surprised. Thank you so
yeah.
much. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Anyway, thank you very much. Thank you for coming. And thank you for our great organizers. Stand up.
Stand up.
They made it happen. Thank you.